Hello, I'm E. Ethelbert Miller. Welcome to The Scholars, a television interview series that explores contemporary scholarship. We hope to engage and challenge your thinking on a broad range of topics. You'll meet a diverse group of scholars who are investigating and thinking about our complex and changing world. Dr. Joyce Ladner is a distinguished sociologist and civil rights activist. She's the author of Tomorrow's Tomorrow, The Black Woman, The Death of White Sociology, and The Ties That Bind. Dr. Ladner is also a former president of Howard University. Welcome to The Scholars.
Thank you. I'm pleased to be here.
You know, everyone has an opinion about what's wrong with American society. Why should people turn to sociologists?
Sociologists, the study of people, individuals, and groups within the environment, unlike psychology that deals more with the mind of behavior. But you should be concerned because sociology provides a set of tools and conceptual frameworks. Frames with which to analyze contemporary behavior. I mean, there's also historical sociology and so on.
When you pick up a newspaper or maybe you're watching television, do you sometimes think to yourself, well, they just don't get it?
In what regard?
In terms of you have a discipline that you've mastered in a way of looking at conditions, and you feel that maybe someone just has something off the top of their head.
Yeah, every single day. I read the Washington Post. In addition to the fact that copy editing is, for a lot of newspapers, is no more.
Well, you know, when you talk to young people today, someone would probably say, I want to become a social worker. I want to be going to psychology or something like that. You don't really hear, at least to me, I don't hear someone in their 20s saying, I want to be a sociologist.
Well, it's more difficult to find jobs because the field is more limited, research, teaching. Applied sociology doesn't train people to go into fields. I mean, you can go into government, you can go into nonprofits, etc. But they're compared to, say, social work, where you out they're literally solving the problems that people present you with. Sociology is a much smaller discipline. It doesn't bode well either for, like some other fields, for. Finding a full-time job on a tenure track teaching, and you also use sociology primarily at the university level.
Right.
So many adjunct professors now must carve together four or five
jobs
at different institutions to make one whole.
Right.
So it's. I still recommend young people go into sociology if they have, but I recommend them primarily to study whatever they have a passion for.
Right. You know, when I think of Joyce Ladner, I think of E. Franklin Frazier, Andrew Billingsley, Nathan Hare, Robert Stable, William Julius Williams, Wilson. Where should one place your work?
Oh, wow.
And what do you consider your major contribution to the field?
I don't know. I don't think like that, and I don't think about it. But if there is a contribution. My favorite work, I should say, is Tomorrow's Tomorrow.
Right.
It was based on my dissertation, a study of adolescent girls. The term now intersection didn't exist back when I was studying, but it's the intersection of gender, class, and race. More specifically, it was adolescent girls coming of age in St. Louis, Missouri, back in the mid '60s, and one of the reasons it's my favorite book because it was, I was not more much older than the girls I was studying. I went to graduate school when I was 20, and some of the girls were 17 and 18, so I wasn't that far from where they were. And I once said, but for the grace of God, my parents stayed in Mississippi and didn't migrate north.
Mm-hmm.
I could have been one
of
the girls.
Right.
Sure.
But when I mention these names, I mean, you're the woman that stands out. I mean, all the other sociologists I mentioned were African-American males. And I wonder, when we look at our society, especially today, we seem to focus on the men more than the women. But you sort of, your work, put them center stage.
Yeah, and the it's kind of interesting as to how I came to study gender roles. We graduate students who were working on this research project at Washington University, that was a National Institute of Mental Health sponsored, I think they gave $500,000, which was like $5 million now, today's right. dollars, to the university to study social problems in public housing. And we studied Pruitt-Igoe, the infamous public housing project that failed. So we're supposed to figure out why it failed. Mm-hmm. And each of us was given the latitude by Dr. Lee Rainwater, who was the director of the project, to study whatever we wanted to. And he asked me one day, what did I want to mm-hmm. focus on? And I said, well, I guess the women, because, and he said, okay, that's good. And had he asked me, or I may well have said, you know, because I'm a woman and I'm interested in it, but that was the sole factor. Mm-hmm. I don't know what else I would have studied. That's the only thing that attracted me then, and even if I went back now to look at it, I would still have the same interest.
Well, if we went back and look at when you're making the decision, you also were around the Institute for the Black World. How important was that in terms of shaping your thinking?
Very, very important. I went, after I finished my doctorate in 68, mm-hmm. I stayed in the St. Louis area for a year and worked. Then I went to the Institute of the Black World. And the Institute was very, very important because it was the black think tank, directed by Vincent Harding, the late historian. I was surrounded mostly by historians, Vincent, Sterling Stuckey, Lerone mm-hmm. Bennett. There were a couple of other people, Bill Strickland.
Right, yeah, I know that Derek White has a fascinating book, The Challenge of Blackness, where he looks at the Institute of Black World.
Right, I haven't read it yet.
Right, and when you see that roster of right. people, even some of the international, you know, in terms of
right.
Walter Rodney.
Like Walter.
You know, I mean, it seems as if we really hadn't had an institution similar to that.
Right, well, you can imagine what it would have been like to be a young person set down in that environment. And although I stayed there only a year, it was the year mm-hmm. in which I wrote Tomorrow's Tomorrow. So that Atlanta University complex environment was just very, very fertile, intellectually fertile. And mm. and I could not think of a better place for me to have honed the framework I came up with in analyzing the behavior of adolescent
girls. Did any of those individuals review your work while it was in the process?
I'm trying to think. I can't remember. Mm-hmm. I can't remember. I think that they thought it was what I was doing was important,
right.
and I remember presenting a colloquium mm-hmm. Presentation one day on the work. But mostly we worked as solitary individuals mm-hmm. there. We didn't have many group projects.
Right.
I mean, the group projects were more programmatic. Mm-hmm. For example, developing Black Studies guides and so on.
How were you influenced by any international events in terms of your thinking? You know,
me personally?
Yeah. You know, many people were influenced by, you know, things that they learned about, say, Ghana and then Nkrumah or South Africa.
Not of events. Well, yeah, events. By the decolonization in mm-hmm. Africa and the Caribbean, we and SNCC, you know, were
right.
quite aware of this, the decolonization mm-hmm. movement. Mm-hmm. And in college, I studied with Dr. Ernst Barinski, who was a Holocaust survivor mm-hmm. from Poland. And he subscribed to the New York Times, all kinds of international publications. And he also taught Russian and German. And he organized for us an African study group. Some of the students went off Crossroads Africa in the summer. And so my international perspective really was honed in college, pretty much.
You know, you edited The Death of White Sociology, Essays on Race and Culture in 1973. What were some of the biases back then when you examined social science research that you wanted to confront and change?
Well, the biggest, the kahuna, I mean, the elephant in the room was my own training mm-hmm. in sociology, because I had studied with absolutely wonderful advisor, the best doctoral advisor, student advisor one could possibly have. But he was also a good friend of Daniel Patrick Moynihan's. He brought Moynihan to speak at one of our staff meetings. And it was the concept of the black family being disorganized.
Mm-hmm. Could you see the problems back then?
I could, embryonically in a way, but more personally, because I knew that wasn't, I mean, I had been reared in a black family, a two-parent household, and I knew families that were single-parent households, but they were not disorganized.
Right.
And even worse was the concept of deviant behavior, mm-hmm. you know, and I had to confront, you know, deviant, it's measured by what, and that was the white middle class suburban family model.
You know, editing a book is very difficult. How were you able to pull pieces together, you know, and make sure things are done on time and the book as a whole captures what you want to say?
Right. A lot of the pieces were included in the book were had been published elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And like Frazier's piece on the challenge of the Negro intellectual or something about the problem of the Negro intellectual. But then I saw the holes, you know. I sat down and I don't work like a lot of people. I work conceptually more than practically a lot. And so I knew people who were in certain areas or who could address certain issues that I wanted to include in the mm-hmm. book, and I asked them to mm-hmm. write.
You know, I remember when the book was difficult to find. Was there ever that problem mm-hmm. in terms of keeping this book in print?
It stayed in print for a number of years, and then it was reintroduced to another audience by Black Classics Press.
Right, exactly, yeah.
So, and even now, I mean, sometimes I go online and to Amazon.com mm-hmm. and buy, you know, secondhand copies, copies that are being sold by individuals. And just always keep one or two around so I can give them to people and so on.
Well, talking about giving things to people, we look outside our windows and we see another movement developing in our country around young African Americans. You coined the term the Emmett Till generation.
Right.
How does the Emmett Till generation look at the Trayvon Martin generation?
A work in progress, and I wonder if we, when we were breaking out of the starting gate, if we were, I don't want to say that we were very, very different, but I think that the times have made this generation very, very different. I think that young people now have every bit as much commitment that we didn't have. We had a telephone, if we were lucky. We had a mimeograph machine, and we did door-to-door organizing. We didn't have social media to call, you know, thousands of people together. My biggest concern with this younger generation is after you gather them together, then what? Mm-hmm. I don't see the grassroots organizing beyond, you know, bringing the large numbers out. And I know that there are a lot of different organizations, and some are doing that. But I went to a conference in SNCC Legacy Committee project. We have a project with Duke University in archiving, digitizing records. And we had a conference last week with some young people from around the country who are from one of the young women who founded Black Lives Matter hashtag and so on. They don't see the world the way we did. I was rather disappointed when one young woman on a panel said we should rethink voting. And then somebody else said at another meeting, a panel I was on at the National Archives, said minimize the importance of voting. My question is, if you don't move, well, let me back up. Mm-hmm. Cortland Cox, who's in SNCC, chairs our Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter, it's a Freudian slip, our SNCC Legacy Project Board. And some of the young people come to him and to us, to different ones of us, and ask, what would SNCC do? What advice do you have to give us? And we eventually said two things. One is, this is your movement. You have to figure it out, much like, you know, to paraphrase Frantz Fanon, each generation must find its mission and fulfill it or betray it. Yeah. But we also said that, you know, in Ferguson, they were referencing specifically, that what are you going to do to get the people out of office? And it always gets back, for us, it gets back to voting.
Well, let's ask something else. In your book, Ties That Bind, you refer and explain a number of important values that each generation should have. Okay.
Right.
One point that you mentioned, you have things like courage, honesty, sense of responsibility.
Yeah, my mother's values.
Right. but there's one in there, which is a faith in God. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I was talking to a number of people. I was looking at Ta-Nehisi Coates' book, Between the World and Me. One of the things in there is the absence of God in terms of his belief.
Yeah.
And is that something that we see this generation, you know, wrestling with?
They're our children, aren't they?
Right.
We raised them.
I guess we must have raised them outside of the church.
Yeah, many of us did. And I am a woman of faith, mm-hmm. But I have flirted in my younger life. I flirted with agnosticism.
Sociology?
Yes. But I don't force my faith, I force it onto other people. I should explain that in the Ties That Bind, the values that I stated were not my personal values, mm-hmm. but were the values that had sustained generations of African Americans.
And they also seem values that seem to be really shaped by the South. Okay.
Very much so.
And so when we look at some of the situations, especially in terms of police, it seems like a northern phenomenon. It's almost like, okay, here's 65 and Martin Luther King's going out to Watts.
Right.
And all of a sudden, you know, young people are like yelling at him because, okay, you don't
right.
understand our movement.
Right.
Is there a regional thing in terms of our values?
I think the foundation of the values are southern. Mm-hmm. But if you look at all the people who migrated from the South to
right.
the North or West and so on, those values went with them, but more important though is over generations, they tend to weaken.
Mm-hmm.
I would not have grabbed the microphone from Bernie Sanders. And I thought those two girls, young women who did, were like spoiled brats.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of my SNCC friends felt the same way.
Mm-hmm.
And especially since it was just tremendous disrespect, but also it was a big gathering of thousands of people for Medicaid.
And Social Security.
Yeah, and very important, you know, it was not, he was going to talk about going to a club or something.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that young people today are just very different. I think to say that you question whether or not people should vote, for me, is just almost heretical. Unless you're offering some alternative way for people to help to empower those that are powerless.
Well, let's look at something. It was going to be my last question, but I'll move it up a little bit. We see in our lifetime, President Obama is President of the United States, which seems to me a definite outgrowth in terms of voting and the importance. When we look at what that has meant for African Americans, he's getting ready to leave office, what has been the difference that he's made?
Well, I think he gave people a sense, number one, pride and hope.
Mm-hmm.
Many of us older heads, older people realized from the beginning that he was going to have a lot of difficulty doing much more than that, because he has faced the kind of opposition that even the most cynical of African Americans would not have imagined. But I think that beyond pride, we will be able to look back I think he has assembled an extraordinary record. And I would dare say that he'll probably be judged by history to have been one of the most effective presidents.
How will we judge him within the African-American community? Because we have people criticizing him, you know, in terms of, well, he's president of the United States, but he hasn't done this specifically for African-Americans.
Right, and I've criticized him for that, but also understand the constraints that were placed on him. I think he should have done more symbolic things, more things specifically for African Americans. I mean, his view apparently is that if I help all poor people, then I'm going to help some black people in the mix. That doesn't necessarily always, you know, it doesn't, it's like filter down, you know, economics. But I wish he had done more. Would it have alienated more white people? Probably, but those were people who weren't on his team to start with. They were not ride or die people.
Well, let me look
but
at
I think
the,
that I right. think that overall, he black people will look back on him mm-hmm. and say with great pride. Mm-hmm. Number one, and another thing is that he's never had any scandals in the White House. He's right. you know.
Right.
He didn't enrich himself.
But you know, when I open up and I ask you this question about like what do sociologists do and looking at these broad questions, okay, it's the complexity there. I mean, how do you expect one person who's president of the United States to solve all these problems?
Well, you can't. And that's why I say symbolically, he could have just thrown a bone here and there. And a lot of people who criticized him would have said, oh, great. Because right. they wouldn't have looked at the substance. They were looking more at the form.
Okay, now this is not a trick question, but is it more difficult running a university as being president of the United States?
Oh, I think I didn't get. I'm sure the being president of the United States has.
You were president of Howard University.
Yes, but that was a very tough year that I had.
It was tough when Obama became ping-pong president.
Oh, yeah,
it was the economy.
But the scale is just. There's no difference.
Well, some people say that managing New York, for example, is more difficult than being president of the United States. You know, the complexity that you have to deal with in terms of balancing things.
Well, I think, you know, it's a matter of scale.
Okay.
Because the problems could keep me awake at night, from Howard could keep me awake at night, especially when I was handed like a cash, a deficit of 25 plus million dollars and had to make some very, very tough choices. I didn't have to, but I did because I wasn't gonna sit there and do nothing. But those problems are just very, very tough. I mean,
let's talk about tough. I mean, because you've written a book that ties it by, and we hope that many people look at this show, deal with the issue of leadership. I mean, you've been there. What does it require in terms of making these tough decisions?
Clarity of mind, courage. And courage does not mean the absence of fear, but the ability to prevail in spite of it. Fairness, the more than anything else, the ability to look at the big picture and then deal with each component part and see how they fit and how to keep kind of balance.
At the end of the day, does this strengthen your faith? Because you mentioned that as being important to who you are.
Yeah, when I was interim president at Howard that year, 94-95, I kept a Bible on my desk, and it was often open to Isaiah, I forget exactly where. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord. And I was dealing also with the terminal illness of my mother in Mississippi. And my mother had been, until she had a stroke in the fall, been my major advisor, even though she was uneducated. Mm-hmm. She would call me and ask me, okay, so what do you got to do today?
Yeah, yeah.
I'd tell her, and she said, okay, well, this is the way you handle this problem, da-da-da-da. And I said, okay, mother. And then at the end of the day, she would call, or that evening, she'd go, now, what happened?
Did you see your mother maybe even more greater than Ella Baker and Fannie Lou Hamer?
My mother would have been more like Miss Hamer than Miss Baker, but some of both within her. My mother was a low-key, but very, very straight-up person. I mean, you knew where she stood on things. She never, as she said, bit her tongue, never held back, and you knew that you were going to get the truth from her. One funny story, my mother could never believe that I had not met Oprah. She said, I said, well, General Colin Powell is going to be on campus today. She said, oh, okay, but when are you going to meet Oprah? That was the funniest thing because she and all her friends watched Oprah every day. And I asked her once, why do you watch? Well, she said, she doesn't look down on us. Mm-hmm. She treats all of us like we're real people. Yeah. But I think that I learned my values from my mother. Mm-hmm. I learned fairness from her. I learned courage from her. I learned how to, she said, make a way out of no way, mm-hmm. how to take little and make something of it. She had a tremendous value in education, even though she did not get very much education. My mother was my heroine.
Okay, well, you know, Joyce, you've always been that to me. You've been really, I've always loved and admired you, and I'm not Oprah, but I'm glad you're on my show. thank you very much, Joyce.
And thank you very much. Okay. I've enjoyed it.
All right. Thank you for watching. I'm E. Ethelbert Miller.